Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to welcome you here this afternoon for the event. My name is George Perkovich. I'm a vice president at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Before I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker and even the greater pleasure of listening to him with you all, I have housekeeping assignments that are very professionally detailed for me. They're idiot-proof. You need to please turn off, not just put on vibrate, cell phones, BlackBerries, and all wireless devices so that we avoid interference with the PA system. If you would like, however, to use an electronic device today, you may, but you have to go outside to do it. Not outside like in the cold, but outside in the alcove there. And then as a reminder, this meeting is on the record. And with that, you all have a brief but perhaps adequate biography of the Director General, so I'm not going to recite it here so that we have more time to allow for his presentation, but Yukiya Amano is the Director General of the International Atomic Energy Agency. He has a long experience at that agency and in service in the Japanese government. And I want to welcome him to make some opening remarks, and then I will ask a few questions, and then we will turn it to a more open discussion. Thank you. Director General.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure for me to be back at the Council on Foreign Relations. When I spoke at your New York office in November 2010, I had been in office as Director General of the IAEA for less than a year. The last 2 years have been very challenging, but also very exciting. I'm thinking in particular of the accident at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant in Japan in March 2011. I have been working in this field for some time. I was ready for accident, and I was ready that it would happen because small sometime, but I never thought that it would be such a huge accident and in Japan. 11th of March was a very quiet day for us. We have finished our Board of Governors meeting on the 10th of March, one day before the schedule. I was relaxed at my apartment when I turned on CNN. I saw the report that there was a breakout of a huge earthquake in Japan. I immediately called my assistant, and I was ensured that the incident and emergency center was activated. The first news was some earthquake around magnitude 8. I thought it would not develop into a huge accident like this, but when I arrived, I learned the news of tsunami, and I understood this will be an extremely important accident. It was the worst nuclear accident since Chernobyl in 1986. The IAEA was actively involved right from the start in helping Japan to respond and to disseminate the information with all the countries. We still are. The IAEA member states agreed an action plan on nuclear safety, which is now being implemented throughout the world. I hosted the International Ministerial Conference on this issue in June 2011, and then action plan was adopted by consensus in September 2011. This is the first time that IAEA could adopt the ministerial declaration and action plan after such an accident, and now the priority is to implement it. The plan is extremely detailed, but to give you just a couple of examples, nuclear power plants have been strengthened against earthquakes and tsunamis, and great efforts have been made to ensure that backup electricity is available if there is a blackout at a nuclear power plant. The east coast of the United States is no stranger to powerful natural disasters and electricity blackouts. The Fukushima accident had huge global impact, especially a negative impact in the confidence in nuclear power. Countries with nuclear power took a critical look at their programs. A few decided to phase out from nuclear power completely. And the future of Japan's use of nuclear power is very uncertain, and it will depend very much on the coming election. But globally, the number of nuclear power reactors in the world will continue to grow steadily in the coming decades. Strong growth is expected in India, in China, and some other developing countries. And many developing countries are planned to introduce nuclear power. I went to Jordan some time ago on some that is a desert country. They don't have any oil, and they don't have the hydro resource. And their source of energy is the gas sent by pipeline, but that pipeline is shut down from time to time. People in Jordan wants to have the nuclear power station at any cost, and they are doing their best efforts. There are some other developing countries like that, and the IAEA is helping them to use nuclear power safely and securely and sustainably if they want to do. Well, we are not intervening in the government decision whether or not to use nuclear power, but if they use, we want them to use it safely. 2 days ago, I addressed a conference of nuclear regulators from around the world on the subject of nuclear security. It was hosted here in Washington by the United States Nuclear Regulatory Commission. The IAEA is at the center of global effort to ensure that terrorists do not get hold of nuclear or radioactive material with strong support from the United States. Terrorists always target at the weakest link in the chain. We try to impress upon all countries the vital importance of ensuring that sensitive material is properly protected. The IAEA's advantage is that we have a variety of activities, and we are well-placed to implement. We provide specialist training, training and equipment, such as radiation detectors for public policy, police, and border guards. We monitor thefts of nuclear and other radioactive material or unauthorized activities involving them. In fact, we have a database, and it is the only authoritative of global database. A lot has been done and achieved in recent years in improving nuclear security in many countries, but there are still weak points. We will hold a ministerial conference next summer to try to address these. This is the first time that IAEA will hold an international conference on security at ministerial level. We would like to see that it would be a good occasion to add political weight to the activities that we are doing in the field of nuclear security. Finally, we have continued to pay special attention to the nuclear program of a number of countries. This is a part of our work of most interest to the people and to media. A year ago, I spelled out in detail the basis for the agency's concerns about possible military dimensions to Iran's nuclear program. We have intensified our dialogue with Iran this year, but no concrete result has been made yet. We are still not in a position to declare that all nuclear material in Iran is in peaceful purpose. In the meantime, Iran has continued to enrich uranium up to 5% and 20% and has expanded its enrichment capacity. This is contrary to the resolutions of the Board of Governors and the United Nations Security Council. Last week, I told the agency's Board of Governors that there is now an opportunity to resolve the Iranian nuclear issue through diplomatic means. The IAEA remains firmly committed to dialogue. Now is the time for all of us to work with a sense of urgency and seize the opportunity for a diplomatic solution. Seen from the United States or Europe, Iran's nuclear program often causes most concern. But from the perspective of countries in the Asia-Pacific region, the North Korean program is equally worrying. The IAEA has not been able to implement any verification measures in North Korea for more than 3 years. Satellite imagery suggests North Korea is building a light water reactor and working on uranium enrichment. This is troubling. And on the latest news on the plan of the launch of missile, will negatively impact the perspective of the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. I believe IAEA has an essential role to play in verifying North Korea's nuclear program. I'm sure that you will have lots of questions about these and other issues. So I will stop here, and I would like to answer your question. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Director General. And I want to make sure I don't hog all the time. But let me ask you a couple of questions to start. One is that you're nearing the completion of your first term. You've been in the agency in this position, the Director General, for over 3 years. Has anything surprised you as the DG?
Not surprised, but the situation has changed a lot. When I joined the agency, Iran has not yet started the enrichment up to 20%. And I did not have access to the information indicating Iran's activities relevant to the development of nuclear explosive devices. When I had a thorough look of the information, together with the information coming in, I thought this is a serious situation. And I thought first, I need to share the information with the countries. And also, I need to make it sure to Iran what are the issues that they have to address. Of course, Fukushima Daiichi accident was a huge surprise for me. Nothing is static, and there is ups and downs. It keeps me busy every day, and I'm enjoying it.
Well, then that's a good segue to ask. So I take from that that you would be interested in having a second term. And I think many people would applaud that result. And so the question is, if you were to have a second term, what would be, you know, two or three things that you would go in thinking, okay, I want to really accomplish these two things in this next term?
The Iran nuclear issue is on top of the agenda. It is a very complicated issue with long history. What I have been doing in the past 3 years, first, establish a clear standard. Every country, including Iran, has to implement a safeguard agreement and other relevant obligations. I mean, the UN Security Council resolutions and other resolutions. They are binding. I provided the clear understanding, assessment of the situation. Then I have identified the issues that Iran has to address. So the situation is clear, questions to address is clear, and now we are negotiating the approach to solve these issues. And I hope in the coming years would offer the opportunity to solve this issue through diplomatic means. The Fukushima Daiichi accident, we have learned some lessons, but it takes years. In case of Three Mile Island accident, they took 10 years to clearly understand what happened in the core of the troubled reactors. It will certainly take time in case of Fukushima Daiichi, and we need to follow up this issue. And last point is that this is, may not be relevant to today's discussion, but nuclear power or nuclear technology is very useful
for the cancer control, for the water management, or for them to address other food security. And I would like to work in this field for the benefits of the people, mainly in the developing countries.
Thank you. Let me follow up. I know there are going to be questions on Iran, but let me follow up a bit on Iran, because you talked just now and in your prepared remarks about the possible military dimensions and the information that was brought to you, and so now you're having to do that investigation. And I guess the question, and Iran has not provided full transparency or answers to those questions. And I guess my question is it possible for the U.S. or the P5 plus one to negotiate an agreement with Iran about its future activities, but Iran's still not answering the past questions about the past? Could the agency, in a sense, stop asking those questions if there were an agreement about the future? Or will the agency always have to ask these questions until they're answered, and it may be, you know, 10 years from now, even if there were an agreement, you're still having to ask those questions? Do you know what I mean?
We'll keep on asking these questions. And what we said in our report is that we did not say that Iran has nuclear weapons. We did not say that Iran made a decision to develop nuclear weapons. But we said we have credible information indicating that Iran has engaged in activities relevant for the development of nuclear weapons. Without clarifying these issues, we cannot provide the assurance that all the activities in Iran is a peaceful purpose. But important thing for us is that our function is to prevent the spread of nuclear weapons. Our function is not to provide the verdict. And some will, of course, want to have access to our site, people, document, information, and some past activities is useful to understand the current one and to have better understanding for the future. But the point is that our function is to prevent the proliferation.
So the Iranian file can't be closed in the IAEA unless Iran actually answers those questions. Is that?
The issues related to the possible military dimension is a part of the problem. We have other issues. If I take up one, Iran has to inform their decision to construct nuclear facilities well in advance. Other countries are doing, but Iran is not doing. We need to know, we need to have better knowledge of their plans to understand whether there is undeclared activities or not. Another issue is that we have we can verify that declared activities in Iran are staying in peaceful purpose. But we have less knowledge whether they have undeclared activities or not. For that, bringing into force the additional protocol is needed. And so clarifying the issues with military dimension is one thing. But we have to bring into force the additional protocol. We have to fully implement the safeguard agreement, including the prior notification of the plan of construction. We call them outstanding issues, and we need to solve these outstanding issues to provide the assurance that all the activities in Iran is for peaceful purpose.
Great, thank you. There's a broader issue that comes out of what you just said, and that I know the agency is wrestling with, but I'd like you to explain it to us. And that is about safeguards and wanting to focus the safeguards process more on thinking of states in their entirety and focusing on trying to see whether they're, to be able to verify they're not undeclared activities. In other words, in the past, the focus has been on declared facilities and materials and accounting. And so a lot of effort and money is spent kind of safeguarding those declared facilities and accounting for them. But proliferation hasn't happened from declared facilities in the past. It generally happens from undeclared activities, and the agency understands that, and the Secretariat understands that, and I believe would like to move in a direction that you could focus more on that. But I understand there's also resistance from a number of states, so this is a very complicated issue. Could you elaborate, in a sense, the complication or the challenge you and your colleagues face in trying to move in this direction?
You're right that in the past, we have focused on the declared facilities and some sending inspectors and some analyzing material accounting was the fundamental source, or even the only source of understanding of the situation. But it became very clear through our experience in Iraq that it is not sufficient. If everyone is honest to declare everything, we don't have the problem. But it is not, unfortunately, always the case. So we start to think that focusing only on declared safeguarded facility is not enough. We have to see the bigger picture, and we have to see the country as a whole. This is the approach called a state-level concept. This has an origin in the 1990s, and safeguard implementation is an evolving process. And we have been developing this method. What does it mean? Of course, the information collected by inspectors is so fundamental and useful. But we have lots of open source materials, and they are very helpful. We have, for example, satellite imagery now. And countries are collecting information, and they provide us. We do not depend on one single source. It does not happen that someone told me, and I say, we think perhaps this is right, and publish it. It never happens. We cross-check all of these informations, and when we think that the information seems to be credible, then next step for us is to ask the country, we have this type of information. Please clarify this. And then we will have better understanding. In this world, there is nothing like zero or 100%. That is not the objective. I said fully implement. Fully does not mean 100%. What we want to do is that we would like to have credible assurance. We want to give a credible assurance to member states that a country's activity is in peaceful purpose. For that, we need to see the country, not facility by facility, but as a whole. The very effective tool is the additional protocol. With that additional protocol, we can ask access to sites that is not declared. For example, this is only one example. In one word, additional protocol is a tool that make us have a better confidence in the activities of our country. And when I joined the IAEA, we had 93 countries that have brought additional protocol into force. Today, I have 119 countries, and this number is increasing. We will continue to our efforts to have better understanding of the country's activities.
I'm mindful of keeping on our budget of time in this time when we're focused on budgets in Washington. But the resistance to that, I mean, because there is resistance to that despite the compelling logic that you laid out. What's the source of the resistance to that? I mean, what's really bothering those that are that aren't so happy to see this move in this direction?
I think there are two different group of problems. One is whether a country bring additional protocol into force or not. Some countries are willing to do it. Other countries have problems to do it, have doubts on this tool, or simply do not have capacity to do it. So one issue is whether a country brings additional protocol into force. we are providing assistance, and we are talking quietly to member states. The second group of question is that what is the concept of state level concept? How far shall we go? And there are some misunderstanding, and there are some lack of communication, and we are intensifying dialogue with countries that have keen interest on this issue. We would like to be transparent. We would like to have the support of all the countries. Fortunately, there is a strong support to strengthen safeguard regime. There is a basic support for the state level concept. But for the details, there are still questions to be addressed. We are asked to provide a report on the concept of state level concept, and we are willing to do. And when to do it, how to do it, I have to think well. In a sense, there are some questions, some problems, but there's a basic understanding and support that safety safeguard must be strengthened. And there is a basic support for the state level concept. For the details, there exist questions, areas which requires clarification, and we are willing to talk to them and to talk all the member states of the IAEA.
Great. Thank you. Okay, we are going to, Barbara Slavin's the first, we are going to take questions. Do what Barbara is going to do. First you raise your hand, then the microphone comes, then you speak in the microphone and say who you are and what your affiliation is, please.
Always good to stay in the front row. Hello, I'm Barbara Slavin. I'm from the Atlantic Council and also AlMonitor.com. Welcome to Washington. Given what's been going on in Parchin, are you reaching a point where it's going to be impossible to say what exactly Iran did at that site? And also, if I may ask a question about Bushehr, recently fuel was removed from Bushehr. Has it been put back in? Are there proliferation concerns involved with that, or is it a safety issue? And if so, what is the IAEA doing to make sure that Bushehr doesn't become another Fukushima, given its strange history? Thank you.
Easy question. Yep.
For the first question of Parchin, in fact, during the time of my predecessor, the IAEA sent a team to Bushehr, Parchin. But Parchin is a huge site with many buildings. And at that time, we did not have enough information to identify the right spot. This time, we had some additional information, and we requested access to a particular site and building of in Parchin. After the after we requested this access, we have observed very extensive activities by Iran. And some this include the demolishing of buildings, use of abundant water, and some removal of soils, and some removing fences. All of these things, and this has been observed by the satellite imagery, and some of them are the imageries that we have bought from commercial sources. Where we stand and what we can do when we have access. As some of these activities are quite intensive, particularly recently, we have concerns that our capacity to verify would have been severely undermined. And it means that we cannot say we are sure to find something. But it is useful to have access to the site. And if we go, we can understand much better the situation. And we are requesting access to the site, but we are also, we have already put lots of questions. And we are requesting access to information, people, and site. So I cannot guarantee that we can find something or not. But I continue to believe that having access is very useful to have better understanding of the past and current activities at Pachin. Next question about Bushel. Yes, some of you have been removed from the core, and it was reported to us. But this does not pose some safeguard problems. We continue to verify Bushel nuclear power plant is in peaceful purpose. Then your next question, is it a question of safety? We don't know yet the details, but they are taking necessary measures. Removing the fuel is already a measure to remedy the situation. And we have good communication on this issue. We don't have much worry of the activities that they are taking. Will it be safe? Ensuring the safety of the nuclear power plant is the responsibility of each country. What we can do is to assist them. In this regard, some years ago, we have sent them a mission to provide for the peer review of the regulatory body of Iran. And we have given several recommendations, including issues related to safety. And we hope that Iran would implement these recommendations, which will improve on the safety, among others.
Thank you. Yes, Deep D, and then we'll go back to this gentleman here, and then I see somebody in the way back.
Thank you, Dr. General. Good to see you again. Deep D Chobe with the Nuclear Threat Initiative. I wanted to come back to the additional protocol, which I understand the IAEA says is an essential tool for verifying the non-diversion of nuclear materials. When the U.S.-India deal was approved, we heard from Brazilian officials that the first victim of the U.S.-India deal was Brazil's non-acceptance of the additional protocol. And the argument essentially was that if the United States was going to give the benefits that were promised to non-nuclear weapon states, meaning access to peaceful uses of nuclear energy to those who stand outside of the NPT, yet we are asking non-nuclear weapon states to take on additional non-proliferation obligations, such as the additional protocol, that they felt that that was very unfair and that was going to be a barrier to them taking on the additional protocol. It's been a few years now. Do you, in your efforts to get states to sign on to the AP, do you still hear that argument, either from Brazil or from other states? Is there still that resentment and that concern?
We hear various arguments to be against, and this issue of discriminatory nature or inequality is one of the arguments. One typical argument is that one country in the Middle East region is not even a member of the NPT, and why other countries should be asked to conclude even additional protocol. This is that may not be exact, but this is it's the main thrust of the argument. And my argument is that additional protocol is a benefit for the country itself. If they implement the additional protocol, we can provide assurance that all the activities in that country is in peaceful purpose, and that will facilitate their nuclear activities. Especially when the activities of nuclear activities of a country is not very extensive, it is not difficult to ratify and implement the additional protocol. And then they can get the assurance from us. We call it a broad conclusion. And they are better off in cooperating with other countries. And almost all the countries in the world are using nuclear power only for energy, only for peaceful purpose. But the golden rule here is trust but verify. And some additional protocol is very effective to give that assurance. Yes, I hear this argument, but there is another strong argument that additional protocol is not for the benefit of others, but for the benefit of that the country. And the fact that 119 countries are now implementing additional protocol is the evidence that this view is gradually and more widely accepted by the international community.
Yes, this gentleman right here. Yep.
Hi, Tom Gelton from NPR. I understand that some of your computer servers were hacked last month, and there's been some speculation that this was Iran, the work of Iran, perhaps in retaliation for cyber attacks against its own facilities. Do you have any comment on that, on that specific incident, or whether there have been any other incidents where Iran may have attempted to penetrate your computer networks?
Regarding this incident of hacking, it is true that there was an attempt to enter into our computer system some months ago, and some information has been stolen and posted to on their website. And the group claims that they have looks like an Iranian name, but it does not mean that the origin is Iran. We are now, what we have done is that we have shut down, we did shut down the server in question, and the information that was stolen were the personal information related to the scientists working in the peaceful application area, like plant bleeding or water management of these type of things. We have taken the measure to shut down on the server, and we checked our computer system dealing with safeguard confidential information, and we didn't find that that type of information has been stolen. But computer hacking is a complicated issue, and we are continuing our investigation and assessment, and we are prepared to take any measure needed to further protect our computer system. If you ask me, this is the only case, I would say there have been some other tries, but we are doing our best to protect our system.
Thank you. Yes, in the back, that's Steve back there. He's coming to you. Hold on. There he is. Thanks.
Thank you. Stephen Dolly with Platts. Director General, has IAEA received pledges of sufficient funding to implement fully the post-Fukushima action plan? And if not, do you expect that additional pledges of funding will be received at the ministerial? If there's not going to be sufficient funding, what aspects of the plan might need to be slowed or curtailed?
Current priority for us related to safety is the implementation of the additional action plan for the nuclear safety, and it requires resources. One is some financial resource, and another is human resource. So far, a number of countries generously made their nationals available as cost-free experts, and Japan made financial contribution and made some experts available for us. the areas which we need funded that, we have to send peer review missions. Peer review missions means we need people and fund to send people. We need to review the safety standards. Again, we need to fund. And we are convening international expert meetings, and that requires some fund. So, so far, we have been financing these activities by the fund, mainly contributed by Japan, but that fund is running out. On top of that, we cannot use the Japanese fund for the activities like making a report on Japan's accident. Using Japan's money to make a report on Japan is a conflict of interest, and I don't want to do, and Japanese government doesn't want to do either. So we need fund. In addition to that, another scarce resource is human resource. When we send missions, we need very good international experts. And again, this is a very scarce resource. Good experts are in demand everywhere nowadays. We need to compete with other companies and other sectors. United States has been generously made their experts available for us, as well as some other countries. And we keep on counting on them, and we keep on appealing other countries which are in a position to do so to provide us more extra budgetary contribution to support the activities to enhance safety after Fukushima Daiichi accident.
May I take two questions at a time? Is that okay with you? Because I want to, yes, Michael, and then over here to David, yeah, and we'll work our way back. She's right there, yeah. And then you can load up David, there you go, yeah.
Hello, Mr. Amano. Welcome to Washington. I have a question. There is a technical process where the IAEA is intensively trying to make progress with Iran. There is a political process where the P5 plus one is negotiating with Iran. Theoretically, the two should be separate, but do you feel that the process in Vienna and Tehran for the IAEA is being held hostage to progress in the political sector, and that Iran both will only give something when they can influence what's going on with the P5 plus one? And how do you feel about that?
Before you answer that, we're going to take a question from David Sanger as well, and then.
Amano, good to see you again. Thank you very much for coming to do this. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the follow-up from the November of 2011 report, which was the one where you laid out most of the details that you've made public so far about suspected weapons-related activity. First of all, have you been allowed by the suppliers of any of that data, including the United States, to provide Iran with any of the documentation that they've long demanded with that? And secondly, tell us about your efforts to interview Mr. Fakhrizadeh, who has been, of course, at the core of so many of these activities that you wrote about a year ago, and whether Iran has indicated any willingness to let you interview any of the central figures in the suspected weapons side of the program.
For the first question, the agency's IAEA's position is that P5 plus one process and IAEA Iran process are different. The Iran IAEA process is different, independent, and separate from the P5 plus one process. And the reason is obvious. People who are participating in these dialogues are different. The scope is different. And some there should these two processes should be separated. In reality, these issues have some relations, and completely separating is not that easy. But despite this, we would like to make progress in process. And that is why we are sending another mission to Tehran on the 13th of December, high-level mission, and discuss negotiate the structured approach, and if possible, have access to a Putin site. The follow-up of the November 2011 report, but regarding the suppliers of information, I cannot say which information, but in general, we can provide the information to Iran when appropriate. But we are now negotiating approach as a whole, and the sharing of information is a part of it. Our position is that we can share the information, we can provide information when appropriate. For the interviews of the central figures in Iran, I said there has been no concrete progress. No concrete progress means includes the interview with some central figures. It was not possible.
Let's Norm Wolf here, and then Gareth in the back, and then we should have time to come to you.
Central figures. Let me correct. To be more precise, what we are asking includes the access to people, information, and site. We have not yet identified a special particular name. That is why I corrected. What we are asking in the negotiation the structured approach is to have access to site information and people. And when we come to the phase of implementation, we will discuss more in details. But we haven't discussed this issue mentioning specific name.
My name is Norman Wolf. I'm an independent consultant. And my question is, it's been roughly 15 years now since the additional protocol was negotiated, and I wondered whether you and your staff have identified measures to strengthen the additional protocol.
And then on the back there.
Yeah. Gareth Porter from Interpress Service. Mr. Amano, the last couple of weeks, there has been a new development in regard to the November 11th report. The AP has published a couple of stories which have resulted in the apparent supplier of the information on the alleged graphing, computer simulation and graphing of nuclear explosions by Iran. And it now appears that it is admitted that the graph was altered in some way from an original of some sort, that it was not a genuine, fully genuine documentation. And this begs the question, because it has been reported in the AP stories that this was indeed one of the series of such graphs that the IAEA was referring to in its November 2011 report. It appears now that that this documentation is being challenged, the authenticity of it is being challenged. And I wonder if you can confirm, first of all, that this was indeed part of the documentation to which you your report in November 2011 was referring. And secondly, do you stand by the authenticity of that documentation despite the reports that have come out now?
First, regarding the strengthening of additional protocol, theoretically or in the future, that can be discussed. But for us, the focus for us for now is to encourage more countries bring additional protocol into force. And I said that we have now 115 countries that have brought the additional protocol into force. It means that tens of countries have not yet brought additional protocol into force. So this is not the right time to further strengthen the additional protocol, but to widen the application of additional protocol. Second question is about the graphs. In the November 2011 report, I said I have identified that computer modeling is one of the areas that we need clarification. We also said in the following reports that we are receiving new informations. But on this specific issue, on whether the graphs reported by AP is the authentic one or not, I hope you understand that I cannot discuss this specific information.
I promised the young lady in the back there, the very back, and then this young lady here in the middle.
Mr. Amano, my name is Manush Purzi. I am from BBC Persian TV. My question is regarding the December 13 meeting. You said from the beginning when you joined the IAEA as the Director General, things have changed quite dramatically. Have you seen any change in the approach of Iranian delegation, Iranian representative that you deal with? And do you have any indication that this time, this meeting may produce some result and may show us that we can have hope to resolve the issue?
And then Corey, right here. Yeah.
Thanks. Corey Hinderstein with the Nuclear Threat Initiative. My question is about the broader mission of the IAEA, and it hasn't remained static. It has changed in its role, and I'm wondering if you could say something about your thoughts about the future role of the agency in the area, for example, of nuclear security, and particularly in the context of the progress that's been made with the nuclear security summits, and then other areas such as fuel cycle and potential verification activities related to nonproliferation or disarmament measures like the FMCT. Thank you.
First, regarding the behaviors of Iranian negotiators or representatives, there are ups and downs on some. Sometimes they are in good mood, other times are not so good in mood. But we have maintained good contact. We are continuously talking with the permanent representative of Iran in Vienna. I met with Vice President Abbasi just after the General Conference in September. And I visited Tehran and had a meeting with Mr. Jalili. So we maintain political high-level channel. We maintain a high senior management and representative of Vienna. So we have a good channel of dialogue with them. On some regarding the perspective of the coming meeting, we would like to produce concrete results. This is the objective. Process is not the objective. We should not go round in process without producing any concrete results. This will even undermine the credibility of dialogue. So we are committed for dialogue. We'll continue our dialogue, but the purpose is to produce concrete result. Can we be optimistic? That is another issue. And we are determined. We are firmly committed to dialogue, and I hope that is the same on the part of Iran. What we can do is do our best efforts. For other activities like nuclear security, Yes, nuclear security is a very important mandate of the IAEA. To be very honest and frank, the activities of ours in this field have been strengthened recently compared to other activities. But I would say that nuclear safety and security is one of the two priorities of the agency. We are committed to function as the global platform to strengthen the nuclear security activities. And next year, we are hosting, as I stated in my introductory statement, international conference on nuclear security at international levels. We can establish nuclear security guidance. We can help countries to implement it. We can provide concrete assistance, like a provision of nuclear detectors. We can provide training, we have a quite extensive database. So the IAEA is the unique and only organization in the IAEA that have extensive, broad competence and capacity and tradition of doing these things. Of course, other organizations are working in this field of nuclear security, but someone should be at the center, and we are prepared to function as the global platform. Other activities for FMCT and others, there is a request, we can use our experience in safeguards to support the implementation of nuclear disarmament agreements.
Thank you. Well, remember when I began, I said the instructions for the moderators were idiot-proof. Well, they're not, because I've just proven that one idiot, anyway, can not do what I was supposed to do, which was say we had time for one more question, because that time has expired. I apologize for that. I am to remind you, which I can do, because I can read this, that says this was on the record, thanks to the graciousness of the Director General. And so let me ask you to join me in applauding the Director General for a fascinating presentation.
Thank you very much.